Today we're going to roll the clock back to 2008. I'm going to take you on my personal guitar journey all the way up to present day. Are you ready to see some exclusive guitar footage of my practicing? Hi Brandon, my name is Brian and I've been playing guitar for close to a year and a half now. When I first began playing, I would notice my playing improved daily, but now I've seemed to hit a wall with progressing my skill in the instrument. Of course, there isn't just some magic tip to instantly become a pro, but I was very interested with what you did to get where you are with your playing today. Believe it or not, I actually get this question a lot, especially on my 3-year guitar evolution video. Now, I normally just replied in just like a short comment, but today I want to go more in depth and just shed a lot more light on this subject and how I got to where I am today. This really all started at a family gathering. My uncle showed us a video on his iPhone, and it was Canon Rock by Funtube. When he was showing it to us, I was just soaking it up, and I was just thinking, wow, this is so cool. I had never heard anything like that before. And so I eventually found a way to download it, and then I just like listened to it all the time, even while I was doing my homework. So I don't know if I got any homework done much, but I was just so obsessed with that video. And the more and more I listened to it, the more I was like, I want to play like that. So it was on the night of October 29th, 2008. It was after church, and I was like, you know what? I'm going to go home, and I'm going to learn some chords. And because my dad actually had a DVD called Getting Started on Acoustic Guitar by Keith Wyatt. So I'm like, I'm just going to use that DVD and start learning some chords. So I got my brother's classical guitar and was just, you know, trying to start learning some chords. My first chord was E, E minor, basically. And that felt cool. When I found that, I was like, wow, this is so easy. I eventually, of course, learned more chords. I got the E, A, D, G, and C. Those were the chords I pretty much stuck with. The B and the F chords were really hard. I couldn't play those for quite a while. That DVD had some loop tracks on it where you could just, you know, play the same chords over and over and practice them. It really hurt my fingers, and I had to stop after a little bit.
That's about as clean as I can get it right now. Fingers are on fire now from that position.
So like I said, I played my brother's classical guitar for the first month or so. During that time, I was really building up my finger strength because if you know anything about classical guitars,
his neck is huge, my hand is smaller.
It's hard to chord.
A lot cleaner, I think. Still needs a little work. Actually, a lot of work. Fingers still have not toughened up yet. Still pretty sore. In fact, I think I'll take a break because I've been practicing for maybe 2 hours.
So it really takes some finger strength, but it was really beneficial to me. However, I did definitely want to have an electric guitar because that was what Funtube was playing. So me and my dad did go to my local guitar shop. We just was looking around, and almost immediately I saw this guitar. It was on this stand, and I was like, wow, that looks so cool. And it was the Black Ibanez guitar. And it was just a guitar for a jumpstart kit. You know, it came with the amp and all that stuff that you need to get started. It was about $130, but that was a lot for me because I had a part-time job, so that was probably like a whole paycheck. I don't remember what me and my dad were actually doing, but we were walking somewhere. We walked downtown and walked back up to the guitar shop. I was thinking the whole time, and I just decided, you know what, this is something I really want to go with. I want to go through with this. So I went back and said, yeah, I want to buy this guitar, but I don't have the money. And they were like, that's okay, you can put it on layaway for 60 days. And I was like, okay, cool, I can do that. During that time, I figured, okay, I've got 2 months to prepare for this. I'm gonna practice really hard.
I'm not doing it right. Still making progress, very slowly but surely. Feels like I'm just gonna take it forever.
I found the money before the 2 months was up, so it was only like about a month or so and I had the guitar. So we all drove as a family to the guitar shop. It was me, my brother, and my mom and dad. And so as we were driving on the way home in the van, We had an AC adapter, so I just plugged the amp up to the AC adapter, had my headphones that came with the kit. I was just rocking out like, yeah, it's awesome. They're just hearing the guitar. Sounds like it's unplugged because you can't hear it because it's going through my headset. Hey, Dad, by the way, it probably doesn't sound like anything, but it's cool sounding to me, you know? And he's like, well, it sounds like you're rocking out to me. On the electric guitar. To make myself feel awesome, what I did was I played like guitar tracks, you know, with solos, and I was just miming to it. Back on the videos and I laugh because I'm like, I'm not even anywhere near the parts on the fretboard you're supposed to be, and it doesn't even look like I'm playing. Sometimes I'm not even using, you know, using my picking hand all the time. I'm just doing stuff and I can actually show you a lot of uncut guitar footage instead of all these snippets that I'm showing you right now. So if you're interested in that, let me know, because I'll try to see if I can find a way to where y'all can get access to that kind of footage. Most of that footage I took has never been seen, probably watched it one time after I videoed it, and that's all. So it wasn't long that I bought this DVD, Getting Started on Electric Guitar with Keith Wyatt. This is where I learned my first scale, the pentatonic scale, and then some other guitar basics like power chords and palm muting. So I was able to apply a lot of this knowledge to songs I was learning at the time, and opened up the realm of guitar soloing, stuff like that, being able to find the notes and have a scale to follow. So this really boosted me in my guitar playing. Paul Gilbert was another guitarist that really inspired me in the beginning. My Jumpstart kit actually came with a little DVD, and he was one of the instructors on there. I don't think that it was really something that went in depth. I think it was just like a few concepts. One thing I really took away from it was the sixth fret was the most evil note ever, so I remember that very vividly. His intro video at the very beginning, it just blew my mind. He still does, by the way, but I was just like, wow, man. I'm like, man, how do you just shred like that? So it was really inspiring for me when I first started guitar. I'm like, I'm gonna be like that. Although I knew my pentatonic scale very early on in my guitar journey, I still played solo guitar with just one string for just a little while, sometimes two strings, but mainly one string, just going up and down. So I was learning, teaching myself my favorite hymns and stuff. It really took some effort. So people actually began to say, hey, go ahead and try using more than just one string. So that was really, I was really out of my comfort zone when I started doing that, but I started applying what I knew about my pentatonic scale and just applied that knowledge to learn, okay, there are different notes on different strings. You know, there are the same notes that you want. It's a whole lot easier just to go up a scale than just to go da-da-da-da-da-da. So I began making backing tracks with an electric piano. I played piano at that time. I would record piano and strings sound, just a simple backing track. They got more complicated as I went, but they were pretty simple at first. Just so that way I could play a special during offertory at church. So that was really a growing experience for me, because when you're playing in front of people, you want it to sound as good as possible. So I just practiced really hard. So that really grew me, because I started, you know, using the pentatonic scale. Because I found that most of the hymns that we played at church or I wanted to play, pentatonic scale worked on, so that was really beneficial to me. I was really using YouTube and ultimateguitar.com a lot to learn my favorite songs, you know, on tabs. I learned how to read tabs around that time. I remember coming across a pinch harmonic and figured out, oh, I call it a pinch harmonic. I called it a squealy for the longest time, which sounds kind of funny. I must have watched like 17 videos on how to play that. Everybody was explaining it, and I was like, I don't get it. That's not making sense. And then I eventually came across Aaron Tomberlin. When I watched his video, I was like, I get it. And so I started playing the pinch harmonic. It didn't sound very good. It really took a while for that pinch harmonic to sound natural. I remember the day that I put my first electric guitar on layaway, and the clerk was demoing the guitar. To me, it looked like he was just bending the string. I was like, cool, bend the string, you get a pinch harmonic.
He was all the way up here, and he bent the strings, and he made it, you know, go really high, and all I did was...
How are you doing that high pitch sound? He's like, all right, I just gotta know what you're doing. Thanks a lot. So I was watching a lot of videos on YouTube still, and I saw a lot of people that had a whammy bar on their guitar, and I didn't know what it was called at first. I had to figure out what it was called. When I figured it out, I'm like, oh, I want a guitar like that too. You know, I have a little whammy bar, I sound cool too. I did end up buying that white Ibanez guitar that you see a lot in my videos. Well, you're buying another guitar. Well, at the time, I you know, had graduated from high school, so I got a lot of grad money. The song I'm Alright by Neil Zaza, that was another song that I set my eyes on. Okay, I gotta learn this too, along with Cannon Rock. So a year had not even gone by of my guitar journey, and I already started posting guitar lessons on YouTube.
No, they don't either. Edit that part out.
I really had no business doing that, but I mean, you know, they were just beginner videos with, you know, concepts and chords and stuff. And that was also around the time I posted my soon-to-become famous Cannon Rock lessons with my white Ibanez guitar. So since I was watching almost every single Cannon Rock, I, of course, came across a free lesson on Cannon Rock by Tron Bold on GuitarMasterClass.net. GMC is also what it's known as. This free lesson, I listened to the demo and I was like, this is different. He plays it different than Fun 2 or anybody else I've ever heard. So since Tron's lesson was free, I was really wanting to learn it. But there was one problem. At the time, our family did not have internet, so we went to the local library to get our internet, but I was trying to figure out a way to record his lesson so I could learn it at home, because you can't just take your guitar to the library and, yeah, practicing. I gotta take my camera somehow to record this, but I just didn't want people looking at me, you know, like, what are you doing? I was going to college at the time, and we had, you know, computer labs, and I had my favorite computer lab I went to. There was one, it was like divided, and there was this one section that was like pretty much empty. I think there was only one lady in there, but she had her back turned to another computer. So I'm like, I'm gonna take my camera and record this lesson. I don't remember exactly how I recorded the audio, but it must have been that I just had like a line-in cord or something, and I just splashed the stuff together so I could watch it and learn it at home. It's funny because it was only a few months and we finally did get internet. After that, I went ahead and joined GMC. So I messaged Tron and I was like, hey, what kind of guitar do you have? I admired his playing so much that I wanted to buy a guitar just like his. So I searched for it online and I called my dad from college. Can I buy a guitar just like his? I found it. Can I pull the money out of my savings to get it? He let me make the choice. He said, yes, you could. And I'm glad I did, because it's like a rare guitar now. You can't find it anywhere that I've looked. So special place in my heart, because It represents Trond Vold, that instructor that, you know, just gave me another boost in my guitar playing and kept me going. I had bought my third guitar and I had not even been playing guitar a year. Actually, it was probably right at my year mark is when I did end up actually receiving it in the mail. It was blindly bought. I had never played it before. In fact, when I first started playing it, it almost felt cheap because of how light it was, because I was so used to how heavy my Ibanez guitars were. I bought that Ibanez guitar blindly too. In fact, here's a secret. I didn't even plug up that Ibanez guitar, that white one. I didn't even plug it up to play it. I just, you know, was sitting down with it, had got it off the rack and was playing with it. I didn't plug it up because, you know, with the whammy bar guitars, with the floating tremolo system, they'll sometimes just loosen the strings up to where it's not tight. So it wasn't even in tune where I could even play it. But they all served me well, and I was happy with them. So in November 2010, I wrote my dad a song, A Father's Love. It was for his birthday. He was really surprised. I was able to apply my knowledge that I had learned so far, the chords, the soloing guitar, natural harmonics that was in the chorus. That was the part that I really loved the most. It was really a breakthrough in my playing. I even played it for offertory at church. You know, my dad prefaced it and say, this is, you know, my son wrote this for my birthday. So that was really special to be able to play that and share that with everybody, because I would say it was my first real composition, and it's still on YouTube if you want to see it. I've been meaning to re-record it for a long time, but it's just never come together. I tried to write some lyrics for it back long ago, but it never came together. So maybe something that I'll work on one day. So I continued to post a lot of covers and lessons, mostly by Red Skillet and Thousand Foot Crutch, through the next few years. And of course, I was definitely learning a lot from GuitarMasterClass.net. I was learning from the lessons, different concepts, different songs, and I could post my video to the forums for feedback, and had a lot of fun in some collabs and contests that were hosted there. Really, GMC was just awesome. I mean, I learned so much from them, not just from feedback, but just from chatting with people around the world, their take on guitar and recording. I learned so much that I would not change anything about GMC, about my experience there. So I just, a huge shout out, huge thank you to the GMC community. During this time, I was really active on YouTube, and I actually had a lot of videos that were big hits besides just my Canon Rock lessons. Of course, yes, I had a lot of Canon Rock videos that I released, but I also did a lot of Happy Birthday Rock versions too. Most of those videos I've like taken down or unlisted because they're just so embarrassing, but at the time people must have really enjoyed them. So in mid-2011, I discovered Drop A tuning. That's what the band Red was playing in, and I wanted to sound like that too, so I took my Red Jackson guitar to the shop and had it set up with super thick strings, and I played it like that for almost 2 years until I finally got myself an 8-string in March 2013. In early 2012, I announced a new channel called Analyzed Within. I wanted just originally a moniker that would separate my originals from all my covers and lessons that I was posting. It had to be something cool and meaningful. So, you know, when I came up with the name, I thought about myself as a person. Analyze Within has a parallel meaning. I am a very detailed and analytical person, so everything that I think about is analyzed within. But also, you know, as I've alluded to already, I'm a Christian, so that means that Jesus is Lord of my life, so His Holy Spirit lives inside of me, so therefore I'm analyzed within by Him. So it's kind of a cool, you know, parallel meaning. But I didn't stay an independent artist. I was going to release an instrumental EP called Living in the Last Days, but there was a family reunion that I was going to attend, and it just so happened that my cousin that I'd not seen since we were like little kids, I got to talking to him about the project and everything, but he's like, hey, I can scream, and I was like, Really? It was pretty much a collaborative effort at first, but you know, eventually morphed into us being actually Analyzed Within, both of us. I was like, you know what, do you want to be a part of Analyzed Within? And so, a welcome team aboard. If you want to see our journeys together, definitely check out the Analyzed Within channel. Starting in May of 2012, my videos actually started to slow down quite a bit until they stopped completely from about January to April that next year, 2013. So from then on through 2014, my videos were pretty sparse, and I was occasionally uploading one of my projects that I was working on. I did release a single called Falling Winter in late 2013, but that's not to be confused with my Falling Winter Christmas album that I released in 2014. So what was I doing during my time away from YouTube, you ask? Well, I was just exploring my sound, and I was also writing the EP with Josh. We were writing lyrics and stuff. We kind of drug our feet during the whole process, but it was a great learning experience because we did end up buying our own equipment to record and things, and I just, you know, applied my knowledge of recording guitar with, you know, to vocals. There was only one place that we recorded away from his house. It was our first time that we recorded Living in the Last Days, the title track. And there's a lot of cool stories surrounding that. If any of you are interested, just let me know, and maybe I'll make a video on that too. For Halloween 2012, I dressed as a mummy.
What are y'all looking at me for? It's a video shoot.
In toilet paper. And I played a song that I created that was Halloween oriented. And then following that, for Christmas, I wrote a hard rock version of Mary Did You Know? And that turned into kind of a metal version in the Christmas album that was released 2 years afterwards. In February 2013, I did the unthinkable. I sold my first guitar, and I know many of you would be like, no, you can't sell your first guitar, that's what you started with. But the reason I did that was because I wanted a better sounding guitar for a project that I was working on with some friends. We were going to play a couple of gigs, unfortunately didn't happen, but I was playing with a couple of friends with the first time, you know, first time playing it with a real drummer in real life, so that was pretty awesome. So I traded my first guitar in for an ESP F50, and it was a great guitar for the time that I used it. This was also around the time that I bought the 8-string guitar too. So up until February 2014, my bass guitar was just MIDI, and I was like, oh, I'm getting sick of programming this. I wish I could just, you know, play it on the guitar and just have it done with, you know? I ended up just buying myself a 5-string Ibanez bass.
Everything's Ibanez.
And it wasn't long after that, it was in April of that year, that I bought a Yamaha acoustic guitar. And to get that, I traded in the guitar that I got in exchange for my first guitar. So I sold that red ESP F50 back to Guitar Center to get that Yamaha acoustic guitar. About midway through that year, I started on a comedy series called Metal Production The Right Way. Now it was never finished, and that was because from July to Christmas Day, I was working on a Christmas album. And the entire process is documented on my Instagram. If you want to go check it out, it's the hashtag Christmas2014album. I even used my Yamaha acoustic guitar on that album. That album was such a huge milestone for me in my music, and I'm really proud of it. I still jam to it this day. And I really want to release a single for Christmas this year too, but I just can't settle on a song. It seems like I picked all the really good ones in that album, so please comment below if you have any ideas. Now, it needs to be a song that wasn't on that album, so go listen to it and just let me know. By the way, you remember the EP Living in the Last Days? We did finally release it, and that was in October of 2014. So, it took us 2 years, but the EP itself was 3 years in the making, so took me long enough, right? But it did finally get released. Living in the Last Days, the song itself, was actually a little bit different from what actually got released, so maybe you're interested in knowing what that sounded like. I could possibly redo it for a future video. And as of this past April of this year, 2015, I no longer have that white Ibanez guitar. You're like, man, you're selling guitars left and right. Well, it's not over yet. The reason I did that was because I don't play that guitar anymore, because my favorite solo guitar is still that Red Jackson guitar. That is when I'm not playing my 8-string guitar as the solo guitar. And it was not long after that, just a few weeks later, that I sold my Yamaha acoustic guitar to Guitar Center, trading it in for a different acoustic guitar that actually was a little bit cheaper. But the reason I did that was because I love the sound of it way better than the Yamaha that I had. So price doesn't always mean that it's a better guitar or a guitar that you will be happy with. In March of this year, 2015, I entered a guitar contest that was hosted by Jared Dines. I felt like this time, yeah, I have entered a lot of contests over the years, but since I've improved so much that I feel like I've got really what it takes to enter this contest. So my goal was to at least make the honorable mentions, which I didn't win, but I did make those honorable mentions, and I was really happy about that. And I did get a lot of traffic on that video, and I thought, you know what? This would be a perfect opportunity to get back into YouTube because I really miss this. I have to constantly remind myself that y'all probably haven't heard a lot of the songs that I've been composing, unless maybe you follow me on SoundCloud or Instagram. But I'm like, yeah, there is content that I can share with you all. So I thought I need to start posting videos more often. It was around this time also that I got a random Facebook friend request from this guy I knew back in sixth grade. Now I saw him and I'm like, oh my goodness, I remember him. And I hit accept. And then we started talking through Facebook Messenger, got to know each other some more. Turns out we believe the same. We like the same music. And we got to meet up at Magic Springs back in August. And my vocalist got to come. And that is when we saw, you know, Red and Thousand Foot Crutch play live. So that was really cool. Before the show, we had talked about Analyzed Within, you know, and see about, hey, would you want to join up as a drummer possibly? I'd actually kind of talked about it with Daniel just a little bit before Josh came with us to Magic Springs. And Daniel was really interested in joining Analyzed Within. He said he had almost given up on finding a band that needed a drummer. And I had been praying for a drummer for a long time, and it seemed like everything was falling into place. So we really hit it off, and Daniel became the official drummer for Analyzed Within. It's really cool because now all we need is a bassist. But I mean, the way I look at it, we'll just take it slow. It may be maybe another year before we find a bassist, but I think it's just gonna fall into place like it did with Daniel. My grandpa likes to say that the Lord is always on time. He's never too late. He's never too early. He's always right on time. And that's exactly how it happened with Daniel. So it's really cool. I really think God is gonna bless my band Analyzed Within, because our whole vision is to glorify God, because He's really the reason I've been able to, you know, play guitar, been able to progress. So now my band is working on this worship album, and our vision is to honor and glorify God. We're going to scale back just a little bit from what we did on our EP. Our EP is really heavy with a lot of screaming, but we're going to scale back to where there's going to be a little something for everyone in this album. Besides, it just, you know, I want to get back to my melodic side, because I do have a melodic side that I want to get back in touch with. So that's what I'm going to bring you. I'm still going to use my 8-string guitar, don't get me wrong. It's still going to be a little bit heavy, but I just want to bring you my melodic side back and have us release this album. And we're going to collaborate together as a band to bring all of our talents to the forefront and just lift it up. At the beginning of my guitar journey, I do remember praying that Canyon Rock never be something I'm tired of. That was pretty much the case for the first 3 years, so that was a great jump start. But now I look to other bands and players for inspiration. But thankfully God has kept me going this whole time. So if there was a secret that progressed me in guitar, I'd probably say it was my passion. Because without the desire that drives you to actually practice, then practice alone just becomes dull and boring. So I would say that if you're struggling, if you're hitting that brick wall, don't give up. Just ask yourself, is this something I really want to do? And if it is, just give yourself time. Have fun. Just don't give up. I believe in you. You can do it. Just stick with it. Peace out, guys.